beautiful loading screen.
Oh man, it's my favorite loading screen. Like black outline and you know, some miscellaneous direct music and just the numbers flashing on screen. It doesn't get any better than this, lads. There is no better loading screen than this in the games.
I do think that is the biggest letdown of the game.
The lack of loading screens?
No, just the loading screens in general.
Oh god, yeah. They were starting to outgrow the PS2 a little bit with the old with the tech, like they were, which is ironic because then when you get to the PS3 era, they don't evolve at all.
No.
They literally regress. It's like Yuke's kind of find their ceiling as a high grade PS2 game, but a low grade PS3 very fucking quickly.
Just yep.
And they have not changed since then, ladies and gentlemen, might I add.
AEW fight forever out now.
We should say here that other wrestling games are available, like Wrestling Quest. That's really good. Play that instead.
Fire Pro.
Fire Pro. That's good too. WF Attitude for the Game Boy. That's good too as well. Somebody kidnapped Stephanie McMahon or some bollocks like that. I don't know. No, I wasn't really paying attention.
Oh man. Betrayal.
Betrayal. That's the word.
I remember that game. Yes. That was awful.
It was awful, you're right.
WWE Betrayal.
Betrayal! In color. Okay then, so, seeing that we didn't win the Royal Rumble, in fact, that credit went to just Monday Night Raw generally, considering they were all the fucking fun that been the last four. So, it's up to us then to try and get ourselves to the main event. And look at those four strong contenders. Orton, Matt Hardy, Bobby Lashley, and Shelton Benjamin. The toast. There is a toast of SmackDown, ladies and gentlemen.
Things are getting a little thin on the ground.
Jeez. I wouldn't mind, but like, there are stars on the SmackDown brand. They're just not around. Like,
well, even then, Bobby Lashley, Randy Orton, absolutely fair. We're playing a Shelton Benjamin. Cool.
Yeah, that's cool. Absolutely.
Matt Hardy.
Yeah, yeah, that's kind of the glaring issue at the moment, isn't it? Like, what is the biggest kind of missing link of that? You know,
these things is not like the others.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Match at No Way Out for the right to challenge the world
heavyweight champion at WrestleMania. I do miss the fully voiced.
Yeah.
It's...
Yeah.
Even just this backstage like segment.
Mm-hmm.
It's nice to see this. Me alone. Apart from that, Randy, I don't want anything to do with you. Jillian, you get your ass back here right now. I would love that to happen on a real fucking Raw or SmackDown. Where an actual genuine interview is being done and it's just interrupted by random. Like random bollocks. I think that
AEW do that recently as well with like the show open is disrupted by a brawl, which is like stupidly realistic for like a blood feud in wrestling. Like it should disrupt TV, shouldn't it?
Hmm.
You know, like even the opening pyro, they're brawling out around the pyro, which is because like again, no, I haven't seen that actually done since the Hardy Punk feud. I want to say on SmackDown, wasn't that done before then? Or something along those lines. It was something that, like, it's not new, rarely done, but when it does, it actually has a punch to it.
Mm. Oh, yeah, this would have been around the time when Mac... It's not when he just came back. This is before... That would have been 2008, wouldn't it? 2008, 2009?
No. The whole Matt Edge thing would have been 2006.
Yeah. Yeah,
2005, summer 2005.
Because yeah. It was even the start of the Radar. It's actually got kind of what gave the Radar character Springboard.
Yeah, yeah. And then he won the belt in January 2006.
Yeah.
So yeah, Matt would have been back for a while now.
Mm.
Just because the photo kind of like the image card that they showed there, I was like, okay, this looks like either just before or after shit had been done.
Mm. Yeah. I think this is when he was on SmackDown doing shit for like a year and a half with MVP.
Yeah.
We often forget that there's like kind of scene missings in the Orton kind of like career, isn't there? It's like Then there's the John Cena era. Then there's a bit about Matt Riddle we will no longer talk about. Actually says a lot about how Randy has changed over the years, that he was like, there was like a team with a problematic cap and it wasn't him. Like, it's such a refreshing change of pace, you know?
Especially considering that when in the early days, like, he was the troublemaker.
He was. He was literally the back shitter. Like, he was dropping some bombs, shall we say.
The hotel pisser.
The hotel pisser, exactly.
Okay. Yeah. Can't get over that story, like, pissing out the window of a hotel. Like,
true Robin there, lads. Like, who amongst us?
Rockstar lifestyle.
Exactly, yeah.
One thing I always go back to with Randy was around 2007, 2008, when he kept getting injured because he had that hyper flexibility thing and dislocated everything several times.
Yeah.
But he went on a Mexican TV show and the host was kind of trying to interview him. Mm. And there was definitely a language barrier thing going on as well. But the host was like, you keep getting hurt. You are
fragile.
And Randy loses his shit. Yeah. Starts like Dr. D and the guy.
Yep. Proper, like, in his face. Yeah. Poor Damien's frozen.
He's just really happy at what happened with Randy Orton there.
Sense of the quantum realm.
Yeah. You've spoken too much of the Orton. You must now be banished from Zoom.
Like,
I know, like, we mentioned it before, but it isn't as scary to how Bobby Lashley has literally not changed from this.
No. Like, normally people either get smaller or bigger.
Mm.
And he has just stayed the same. Jacked. Like,
yeah. It's nuts. Fuck. Actually insane.
Like, you have to, like,
you would have to, like sell children to get a fucking, like, you get, like, a wish good and strong enough to keep those genetics. Like,
like, to be that big and jacked for that long.
Mm.
Like, and I mean, like, it's just madness. Like,
it's insane. Absolutely insane.
Bobby Lashley.
Yeah.
Sorry, Lashley, my internet crapped out there. I saw a picture someone shared earlier of, like, you know, Raw or SmackDown 2007 versus SmackDown now, with the picture of Carlito, Bobby Lashley, John Cena, Rey Mysterio.
Yeah.
And Bobby Lashley hasn't changed.
Hmm.
It's been 15 years.
Yep. It's fucking nuts. It's actually fucking nuts. And now, once again, we are either... And for a refreshing change of pace, we're actually teaming against Matt Hardy as opposed to teaming with him. Like, I know Matt Hardy has been, like, a standalone pick a couple of times in this series, but, like, I'm just fascinated to see what his year has been like in this season, because it looks like he's just been the spare prick for the entire year. You know? Like, he's had a literal Miz season. Where, like, he's just, we'll just throw him in here for a while. We'll just throw him here for a while.
Story of his life.
Really fucking is, like. I know his games can be inaccurate at some points, but they really aren't in this one. They weirdly got this one accurate.
I mean, like, going back to what you're saying, Jamie, is the fact that, like, everyone else has changed in that 15 years. Like,
yep.
Cena is losing his hair. Like, sorry, he has hair to lose now.
Yeah.
He didn't have any hair. He grew some hair. Now he's losing it.
Yep.
That's how much he's changed.
Yep. Fucking Carlito is jacked.
Yeah.
Mysterio is jacked. Like,
and also now ridiculously tattooed by comparison.
Yeah.
Yep.
Like, Bobby Lashley
is just remained the same.
Mm.
Like, the only difference is that he wears glasses now. That is actually the only difference now. Because when he comes out, he actually wears his glasses.
Yeah, the only difference between Bobby Lashley of 07 and of now is that Bobby Lashley actually, this day and age, wears clothes. Like, he isn't just in his cacks and boots the entire time. He actually wears clothes.
Yep.
You know that one time where, like, Randy Orton actually had, like, street attire and everyone, like, freaked out, going, oh my god, he's wearing a hoodie. Like, he's fucking, like, Lisa Lionheart and the fucking new hat, you know?
I want it.
But look, a new hat.
The wrestling business has been good to those boys. They can afford clothes now.
Although, what I did find weird, and it's only recently that I noticed it. So, for years, it's always been a case of, like, right, these lads, like, they're in great nick and all that, like, but some lads look even bigger when they're wearing their street clothes.
Hmm.
Whereas you go to 08, 09, Randy Orton, he looks smaller.
Yeah.
He did, yeah.
Like, drastically smaller. Like, he didn't look impressive at all. Even though he was lean and cut to shit. Like, just, no. Like, that was that fucking, what was it? Legacy era.
Mm.
Like, punting the McMahons.
That's probably kind of like a bit of a, kind of like, kind of illusionary kind of thing on our side as well, because like we would naturally kind of scale up people if we see them when they're all brought out as well and the lights hitting them a certain way, and then you kind of put them, as I said, in darker clothing, and then they just naturally look a bit like a bit more constrained because I know the lights hitting them differently or stuff like that, or again we're just like actually just like adding width and height to them when we see them as wrestlers, you know. It's like it's always the same thing where, like, you know, like if you're like, as we've said about wrestling as a homoerotic sport, but like I have my friends. I have never seen their fucking nipples or armpit hair, but I've seen a lot of men's nipples and armpit hair. But it's like, oh no, they're just wrestlers. It's their standard uniform. As if that makes a fucking difference, you know, kind of way. But it is that kind of thing where, like, you're just like, it's stuff that just doesn't register as part of your, like, yeah. I've actually never thought of it that way until you actually see, like, someone almost like wearing a street clone, like, my god, you're strangely clothed for this segment. What's going on here? Where are your knee braces, young man? It's always a bugbear of mine where, like, someone is actually wearing a street fight but wearing their wrestling gear. It's like, no, go back in, put some jeans on, and come back out. You have not followed the rule book, sir.
Jeans, and I don't care where you get them, but get some fucking cowboy boots.
Get some fucking gears right now. Yeah.
Get some chaps on him. That's what we're missing. Assless chaps.
Assless chaps. There we go, lads.
Hey, Shawn Michaels tried to bring those in.
Hey, like, this is a guy that recovered from fucking brown pants. It's mad that, like, we remember that. Or Triple H wearing that random, like, fucking white pair of trunks for one match.
I was thinking Triple H in the bicycle shorts.
Yeah, bicycle shorts, that was what I was going to say.
Yeah. At least the fucking bicycle shorts, there was a reason, because he had a groin injury.
Yeah.
But when he actually did the white trunks, like, that was strange.
Mm.
That's and wrestling fair. With white boots. That was even weirder.
Yeah.
There's been a few modern effects of that as well, hasn't there? I mean, like, when was it when Killer Karrion Kross got his first main event push and they put him in fucking BDSM gear because Vince thought it was funny or just wanted to emasculate the poor bastards? Like, I don't know, whichever happened to his brain first, you know?
Now, do you know what that was? He knew about the Ventura impression long before everyone else did and just said, I'm going to fuck with this guy before he gets a chance. So straight away, this is why I should have done the Ventura.
I didn't know that's where you were going with that. I was thinking, like, wait, does Vince have a Jesse Ventura impression? And is he just really annoyed that Karrion Kross does it better? It's like, what? Of course I have a Jesse Ventura impression. Ah, Predator! Fuck you!
Like, Ventura is one of the very few people that actually beat Vince in court.
That's true.
Decisively, like, beat him. And never forgave him for that.
Well.
Nah. I mean, like, they've done business.
For SummerSlam, yeah.
They've done business, but, like, he's definitely not forgotten that.
It's almost like Vince is threatened by people who are smarter than him.
Well,
how that works.
Well, let's not go giving Jesse that kind of credit.
I'm just denigrating Vince's intelligence, to be honest with you.
Fair enough. It's a low fucking bar when it's Jesse Ventura. The lizard people are a thing.
Yeah.
For him, at least.
Is it bear in mind that people can be intelligent but also really fucking crazy as well.
Yeah,
like, there is a lawful good and there's a chaotic evil, you know? there are scales to this kind of thing, you know?
There's a reason why he is off the grid, because he is fucking batshit crazy.
I live off the grid because I don't believe in the government looking at my water. Or some other shit like that, I don't know.
You were the fucking governor.
They put microchips in the chicken. Yes, Jesse, of course they do.
They turn the freaking frogs gay!
I've lived on bull serum my entire life. Yes, of course you have, Jesse. That's great, dear. Just go.
To be fair, like,
I was in Running Man. Yes, of course. I know you were. That's great.
In Predator as well. Which I'm sure another joke could be made there, but I'm not going to go there.
He's a predator. Which one? Oh.
That movie was full of them.
Yeah.
Fucking industry is full.
I was about to say, it's just like, are you with the film there or just any or any progress show? Because that could both qualify.
This will turn you into a goddamn sexual tyrannosaurus. Like chewing the fucking tobacco and all. Fucking what a nasty.
And then he tried to be the Terminator in his own movie because he was jealous of Arnie's success.
Yeah. Abraxas, wasn't it?
It's a fucking terrible movie. It is by far the worst sci-fi movie I've ever watched. Because the science fiction actually is just genuinely fucking dumb. Like there's technobabble and there's bad science fiction in that, like, it, like, tries to explain it and does it arse ways and never happens. But then you'll have situations like Abraxas where we're just not going to tell you at all, and you're just going to just accept it. And of course this person's 1,000 years old, because why not? It was like, I don't fucking know, you tell me, you're the one making the fucking movie. And again, like a 1,000-year-old cyborg police detective with a fucking rat tail, no. After year 506, you'd think someone would have fucking pulled him aside and said, mate, let it go. Like,
you think
just,
you'd either shave or fucking give him the fucking the wig. Like, your star is a fucking, like, balding man. Like,
I don't. But are you insinuating that we can't be leading men, Foxy? Is that what you're trying to say there?
No, I'm not insinuating. I'm blatantly saying it.
Right. Well, just taking your clear, hairophobic nature out of it, like your hairism out of this, you know.
Hey, you're just making up words now.
Well, I'm fucking sorry, but like, you know,
scientists that just make up words so people are scared because it's all big words and we're not educated enough.
I'm a chemist. I'm not a fucking entomologist, you dipshit. There's not a fucking difference between them. Oh, why don't you just use your science to rub that skin there? Fuck off, you hairy bollocks. There's no difference in that, okay? I'm a fucking chemist, not a poet, you fucking arsehole.
Also, I may not be balding, so I literally don't have any skin in the game, but let me tell you something, brother. The balding look was very popular for a long time in certain businesses due to certain people.
Due to certain people, precisely. You know, it's a sign of high testosterone, which is what we keep telling ourselves every night while we cry ourselves to sleep.
That's it, I'm a doctor, not a pool man.
Yes, exactly. If you want a catchy name, ask fucking Anthony Wordsworth.
Yeah.
But even then, like, at least with the Abraxas kind of thing, like, you can justify him being bald because if he's a cyborg, he has a giant metal head he could clearly use to say to kill people. That's fine. No issue with that. The rat tail serves no tactical purpose at all, rather than just to emasculate the person who has it.
It's super stylish for whatever year it was made.
Yeah, exactly. Or they're going to give us some like a hand wavy thing where, like, actually, no, his entire race have rat tails and it's seen as a badge of honor.
It was to hide the antenna, damn it.
Maybe that is the antenna. It's just.
See, there you go.
Yeah, there you go. Now you have. Well done, Jamie. You've been able to explain the plot of a practice better than the people who made it.
With very little context.
Very little context. And do you know what the worst thing about a practice was the soundtrack. The soundtrack was literally nothing but like fucking porn jazz.
Oh,
it
wow.
was like you know, like Lethal, you know, like with Lethal Weapon always had those beautiful sax solos and stings and like fucking brings you back into Miami Vice territory. Yeah, imagine that, but up to 11 and all the time. You know, no like sensible deployment of the sax for a highly emotional sting point or end of a scene. No, that through the entire fucking movie. Like,
I'll be honest, I came into this conversation not knowing that Abraxas existed. I'm leaving it knowing that I will watch this movie.
It's on YouTube, Jamie.
It sounds marvelous.
It's like the movie equivalent of Abandonware. No one wants to take ownership of it. Again, I'm trying to remember who the fucking enemy, who the villain of the piece was again. I can't remember his name. I remember his face, but I can't remember his name.
You have access to the internet. Just look it up.
Yeah, so I was trying to... So Sven Ollie Thorsen, that was his name. I just couldn't remember the guy's name. Because he was... what was it? He was... Wasn't he Zangief or something like that? Oh, yeah, no, he was in Conan the Barbarian. He was in the Conan series. Of movies. Praxis,
Guardian of the Universe. Fantastic. Well, that's one for later.
Yep. Featuring a Belushi brother.
And created by Jack Kirby.
Yeah.
What?
Yep.
I don't think he had anything to do with the movie, to be fair.
I can't imagine he did something.
No, because I think even like this, the ghost of Jack Kirby would be highly offended at this.
Oh, we have a winner.
Yep, because I missed the elbow drop.
Fuck.
No, the match had been going on for 15 minutes, so I actually didn't really care at that point.
Take it home. Home.
I mean, usually when like you're in a tag team match and everyone's gone red, it's just a matter of time, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But now, what does that do for the fatal four-way? No way out, I hear you ask. Absolutely nothing. It was a dead rubber. Because the storyline about this Road to WrestleMania is not about the world title. It's about Randy Orton being weird to women.
Very accurate for the time, as I understand.
It's quite self-critical, I have to say. Like,
they're leaning in.
Yeah, isn't it kind of weird that the video games seem to be more on the ball with the real lives of wrestlers than the actual, like, you know, programming? What do they know? What do they know?
We're nearly veering into the territory there of like they're trying to tell us.
Yeah, exactly. You read that fucking dialogue with Benoit earlier on in the game.
Yeah,
that was unsettling.
That was scarily on point. And this game was developed a year before, you know, he locked the dogs in the pool. So, you know.
Yeah. Although I have since seen a promo from him in 2001.
Yes.
Where he was, or no, 2000, where he was shooting with Undertaker. And he was telling Undertaker that next week his wife and kid wouldn't be watching Raw because he was going to do something awful.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't think they ever recovered from watching SmackDown, did they?
It's, not great.
No,